Good morning, everyone. My name is Mark Bosco. I'm the director of the Hank Center for the Catholic Intellectual Heritage. And it's a great pleasure for me to welcome you to Loyola University's full-day commitment to learn about, to talk about, and to celebrate on some levels Pope Francis's encyclical Laudato Si, called Praise Be to You in English, and taken from the words of St. Francis of Assisi, that patron saint of eco-theology. The document is a call to witness environmental sustainability as a matter of ecological as well as social justice. The premise of our gathering then, part symposium, part town hall meeting, part teaching, is to have a community conversation, a Loyola-wide response to Pope Francis's call for both a church and a society that cares for our common home. So many hands have helped create this day. Administrators, faculty, staff, and students, both graduates and undergraduates. I want to thank all of them for all their hard work. And I want to thank all the many co-sponsors who are supporting us in this endeavor. The President's Office, the College of Arts and Sciences, the Department of Theology, Catholic Studies, and the Institute for Environmental Sustainability. I also want to single out Dr. Michael Murphy, the Director of Catholic Studies, for the tremendous amount of work he has devoted to planning and organizing this with so many students and so many faculty. So thank you, Mike. Finally, part of this day is a celebration of how the soul, as well as the intellect, how art can respond to this call to ecological matters. Join us this afternoon out on the West Quad, where students will be leading us in a teach-in through different music, dance performances, even I hear a little rap music happening. So, tabling with student organizations and community organizations as well. And finally, I'd like to call your attention to the back of the program that you have and invite you all to continue this artistic encounter with faith, ecology, and art when Father Bill Hart McNichols offers a lecture Thursday night on this new icon that now hangs on the atrium in the IES building. Father Bill will be with us for most of the day today, and he's going to help lead the Taizé prayer tonight in the chapel at 9:30 p.m. But please come and join us at 3:30 in the Palm Court tomorrow, where we're going to have him talk about the spirituality of icons, ecology, and the making of our icon. Again, it's my pleasure to welcome you, and a great privilege then to invite our interim president, Dr. John Pelissero, to add his welcome as well.
Good morning. I'm delighted to be here today to offer a few words of welcome at the start of this program on caring for our common home, conversations on ecology and justice. It's of course very timely that 2 weeks before Pope Francis's apostolic journey to the United States, we are gathering for this discussion of the encyclical. And I'll admit that while I'm impressed with the crowd that's here today, I can't help but believe that if the Pope had included Chicago in his rock star tour of the United States, we would have had a slightly larger turnout. But thank you all for being here and for the participation that you'll be providing in the symposium and events throughout the day. The program today is a community gathering designed to underscore the importance of an integral ecology, and as Pope Francis put it in Laudato Si, a recognition of the inseparable bond between the concern for nature, justice for the poor, commitment to society, and an inner peace. Our physical world is in crisis, and we're confronted with the reality of environmental degradation and its disproportionate impact on our lives and of the lives in particular of the poor and the vulnerable. As an academic institution rooted in Catholic and Jesuit tradition, we at Loyola are uniquely positioned to apply our excellence in teaching and research to understanding these complex issues and to move us as a society toward lasting solutions. In our campus conversations over the last year, ecology and justice issues were highlighted as ones that needed to be addressed in Loyola's future and in Loyola's new strategic plan. That plan, called Plan 2020, Building a More Just, Humane, and Sustainable World, was approved by Loyola's Board of Trustees in June. One of the four institutional priorities detailed in the plan commits us to leveraging our talents, particularly the talents of our faculty, and the enthusiasm of our students to identify solutions to societal challenges, including climate change, environmental degradation, and the experience of the poor. We're rolling out information on our plan in ways that all of you can become engaged with this important project throughout this month. Today's conference provides an excellent framework for the direction we want to go as a university community in these next 5 years. And it provides an extension of our commitment to environmental sustainability that places the university in close harmony with the Pope's social teaching. I want to add my thanks to Dr. Michael Murphy, who really did the lion's share of organizing for today's event, as well as Father Tom Reagan, Dr. Nancy Tuckman, Dr. Aana Vigen, Father Mark Bosco, and our sustainability director, Aaron Dernbaugh, as well as the staff members and the many undergraduate and graduate students who worked so hard to put together today's events. I wish everyone a great day of learning and sharing, and now I'll turn the podium over to Dr. Colby Dickinson, who will get the first panel started. Thank you.
It's a real honor to be here today and to be moderating this first session of what looks to be a very exciting day of scholarship and of learning. I think this day really represents a bridge between what the Pope has been doing in this recent encyclical on the environment and a lot of the ongoing work that's been part of Loyola's own identity and mission. So I'm very excited to hear more of the connections and to look at some of the critical responses to the Pope's recent encyclical. As a moderator, I don't want to say too much. I'd rather get this going and hear the great talks we're going to be hearing today. So I'm going to do my best to moderate what's billed as a symposium town hall teach-in, which I really have no idea how to moderate. So it's all these things at once. We'll kind of just get it started and see how it goes. Our first speaker is Aana Marie Vigen, who is an associate professor of Christian ethics here in the Department of Theology. She's an active member of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, the ELCA. Her scholarship and teaching attempt to tackle pernicious socioeconomic and racial ethnic inequity, especially as it manifests in health, healthcare, and climate change realities. So she's bringing a rich background of diversity to her talk today, and I think we should welcome her with that in mind.
I know you don't want to sit in front, but there really are seats up in front. So please, don't, come on you guys, make yourselves comfortable. I need to get the screen rolling here. Make sure that we have power again. Yes? Do you see anything?
Like, Yeah, that's good.
Good morning. What a day. Thanks to everyone, again, who has made this possible. And I also want to thank you, Dr. Michael Murphy, for doing so much very quickly with a budget and with panache. We owe you a real debt of gratitude. As the first speaker out of the gate this morning, my task is to use Chapter 1 of the encyclical, Laudato Si, as a launching pad for moral and theological reflection. Now, I'm going to be frank with you all, and please keep coming in. Don't worry. Chapter 1, What is Happening to Our Common Home? It's not exactly a feel-good read. What's happening? Well, in a nutshell, rising seas, massive biodiversity loss, ubiquitous pollution, intensifying global inequalities and hardship. I don't know about you, but my first reaction to such news is to pull the sheet over my head. Closely followed by a second reaction, which is to look for a shining rock star to lead the way. Huh? Bono's done a lot of good things. Maybe some of you prefer Queen Bee. But today we all know who it's about. A true rock star, Pope Francis. And yes, I am a fan, and I have to admit that that's saying a lot because, as Dr. Dickinson just said, I am Lutheran. So some of you know what that means. We're all coming up on the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. But, you know, we can't leave the heavy lifting to the Pope. For one thing, Francis is not a spring chicken. But more to the point, as he himself makes clear in the very first pages of Laudato Si, he wants to engage everyone of every age, culture, religious, and philosophical background in a lively conversation. So as a very small part to that larger endeavor, I'm going to respond to the Pope's call with Christian ethics in three parts: heartbreak, confession, and a call to conversion, to risk love. Heartbreak. As I tell my students on the first day of my core ethics classes, the first step of ethics is to pay attention. Before arguing what we ought to do or what ought to be, we must describe as fully and as accurately as possible what is. Even more, nuanced ethical reflection requires not only compelling argument, but a dogged willingness to be heartbroken by what we witness. In this encyclical, Pope Francis unflinchingly describes the depth and the breadth of the ecological crisis. I'm going to highlight four constellations of challenges facing our beautiful and fragile home. I've titled them heat, stink, sickness, and injustice. Heat. I'm assuming that most of you understand and know well that the planet is accelerating at an alarming rate. This is what this looks like. As you can see here by this map, National Geographic had to redraw the Arctic because of the rapid loss of ice. The big melt means less stored fresh water, which we all need for survival, and rising sea levels that are swallowing up land, not simply in remote parts of the world that maybe you've never heard of, but in Alaska and along our Gulf Coast. Deforestation makes matters worse. The trees are the planet's lungs. They produce oxygen. They absorb CO2. So cutting them and losing too many of them to wildfires have serious climate consequences. Weather patterns are being affected. That's the California drought ongoing. Now, to be clear, climate change does not cause droughts, fires, floods, or hurricanes. This is Hurricane Sandy. But it does contribute to their frequency and their intensity. In sum, we are losing vital places that we need to grow food, to fish, to live, to dry soil and to acidic oceans that are robbing both land and water of their ability to be healthy homes for planets, animals, and people. This slide is particularly troubling because it shows how it is massive in terms of, by 2015, we could lose all the world's coral. So we won't be able to find Nemo, let alone anyone else. But it's not just about losing fish that are beautiful. It's about losing habitats and food and yes, beauty as well. Stink. The industrialized world, notably the United States, is a beast of a consumer and polluter. You know, if the rest of the world consumed at U.S. levels, we would need, as this slide shows, 4.5 planets to meet the demand. Each year, the world generates 2.6 trillion pounds of garbage. Now, that's about the weight of 7,000 Empire State Buildings. And wealthy, industrialized countries like ours, we contribute almost half of the world's trash each year. To give you a sense of that, just Americans alone, we generate 30 billion foam cups, 220 million tires, and almost 2 billion disposable diapers into the landfills. Hardly any of this, by the way, is recycled. Pollution. Did you know that pollution in China can change weather patterns in the United States? And did you know that there are several trash islands, I mean, complete islands made of garbage, that are in the oceans the size of Texas? Floating around? The Mississippi River carries enough nitrogen pollution into the Gulf of Mexico each year to create a dead zone that's about the size of New Jersey. The Pope is blunt. Our home is beginning to look more and more like an immense pile of filth. Sickness. Nearly 800 million people don't have enough food. Hunger kills more people every year than AIDS, malaria, and TB combined. About 7 million premature deaths are linked to air pollution. According to the United Nations, almost 800 million people don't have access to clean water, and 2.5 billion lack adequate sanitation. We face tremendous fresh water scarcity, and the Pope spends a lot of time discussing the implications of the water crisis. We have greatly overdrawn our aquifers, and we have lost trillions of groundwater to evaporation with the warmer climate. Water truly is the new oil. In all, the World Health Organization is calling climate change the biggest health threat this century. Between the years 2030 and 2050, it is expected to cause approximately 250,000 additional deaths a year from malnutrition, malaria, diarrhea, and heat stress. Injustice. One example is biodiversity. Biodiversity loss is an injustice issue because all kinds of species and cultures are being profoundly threatened, and yet, in comparison to the fossil fuel industries, they have had far too little voice or vote. So let me just give you one example of this in terms of the oceans. We are now facing extinctions happening at 114 times the normal background rate. We are moving from a vibrant and dazzling diversity to anemic monocultures. Here, Pope Francis calls out those who, quote, have turned the wonder world of the seas into underwater cemeteries bereft of color and life. The takeaway. First, such realities make for a pretty tense home. Climate change exacerbates every other social ill. And here's one specific example. A 4-year drought, the worst in Syria's history, preceded the current civil war. This war in which well over 100,000 people have died, and that's mostly civilians, and hundreds of thousands of others have been displaced. We have only begun to see the waves of refugees searching for new homes, in part due to climate change. Second, riddled throughout all of what I have said so far is inequality. The cruel irony is that those who contribute the least to these daunting problems are paying the highest price. It's a lot to take in, isn't it? Grappling with the ecological crisis, as with any authentic work in ethics, is hard. As Bill McKibben puts it, these facts should feel like body blows. If they only registered at an abstract level, if we remain or become aloof or cynical, then something is seriously lacking in our moral reflection. You see, Pope Francis asks us to confront not only harsh planetary realities, but also parts of ourselves that we might rather not see. Christianity, as other great religions, is distinctly good at opening our eyes to the intractability of human limits and morality. Human limits and mortality. At its best, no faith tradition offers an escape from death or finitude, but rather offers a meaningful movement through both of them. Come on in, you guys. Come on in. Really, you got to see this stuff. This is really important. This is a big day here, Loyola. Come on in. Christians who are present today might want to think of this moment of reckoning as akin to Good Friday, which, of course, is utterly horrible Friday, the day when death dies, when all seems lost, when we are bereft and overcome with the realization that we contribute to injustice, to the abuse and the neglect of our shared home and its inhabitants. This awakening begins with taking responsibility for our failures and our blind spots, for the things that we too often have done or have left undone and that have directly or indirectly hurt others. Human or not, and especially those who dwell far from the centers of power, comfort, and media spotlights. Such a moment is ripe for confession. not only individual, but collective. And this is what I mean. Before we can take imaginative steps to fashion a new and sustainable future, we have to unfreeze or unlock our hearts so that we can turn them outward in authentic love of self, of neighbor, God, and of course the planet. Here's a confession that I just want to give you an example. This is something that in my Lutheran denomination we say as a regular part of worship. Now, these words aren't mean to beat ourselves up, and I know they may not resonate with all of the people here from very many traditions, but what I want you to understand is that we say these words in my faith community to remember who we are and to whom we belong, so that we might know deep in our bones that we were, as Pope Francis puts it in this encyclical, made for love. Part 3. A call to conversion. Now, I want to be clear here. This is a Jesuit and Catholic university, but I am not saying that everyone needs to become Jesuit and Catholic. I'm staying Lutheran, and you are welcome to keep your religious tradition. And that's another key thing that I love about this encyclical. Pope Francis shows great appreciation and love and respect for all kinds of religious and philosophical traditions and the wisdom that they offer. So this is what I mean by conversion. Not to a particular religion, but to love. Throughout Laudato Si, Pope Francis expresses profound love for humanity and strong hope that we can create a more just and livable future. He tells us the truth about our hearts, sometimes broken, other times hardened, and yet resilient, always capable of healing and love. Now, as soon as I use that word love, I know that maybe some of you are thinking about emoji, or worse, this. Okay, this is Hallmark. I am not trying to sell you a greeting card. We're not talking Cupids and doilies and little Valentine's candies. No, this is what the human heart looks like. It is a fleshy muscle, gritty. Do you know that it is the only organ in the human body that only rests between beats? Your brain gets a bigger rest than that. It is a gritty, tough muscle. No little arrows flying through the sky, in other words. Francis writes, "For all our limitations, gestures of generosity and solidarity and care cannot help but well up within us because we were made for love. We're made for love, people, not for destruction or despair. The heart of the Christian story centers upon a prophetic claim to new life, that we move from Good Friday to Easter. You know, it might be autumn, but it's also spring. As emphasized by numerous theologians, resurrection is not only or not so much about quote-unquote saving souls, but about practicing acts that restore and renew life and well-being here and now. Poet Wendell Berry exhorts us to practice resurrection, to embody hope now in order to transform lives, materially and spiritually. We can start today. We can start anew, together, right here. But we can only do this if we are willing to risk love, to risk falling in unabashed love with this world. On this point, Pope Francis echoes Saint Francis, and he speaks in terms of beauty and affection, awe and wonder of our sister Earth. Pope Francis reminds us that what we feel when we fall in love with a person, we can also feel when we gaze at the moon or sun or the smallest of animals. And I would also add, the Chicago skyline. You see, rather than lose heart, or even worse, become hard-hearted, we have to be strong enough to stay tender-hearted, to feel empathy, passionate love, deep grief. We have to feel both heartbreak and love so that we can have the courage to act with purpose and conviction. You see, Francis doesn't just want you to read Laudato Si. He wants you to let it work on you and for you to work it in the world. The good news about the severity of the challenges that we are facing is that everyone here and at this university and in this country and in this planet has something to contribute. Every skill set, every religion, every culture, every political perspective is needed. There is abundant work for scientists, engineers, entrepreneurs, business leaders, lawyers, politicians, and here's what's really exciting, for theologians. We got a part to play, and ethicists, and pastors, and priests, and women religious. Also for storytellers, and artists, and poets, and dreamers, and musicians. Now is our moment. Being immobilized by the magnitude of the problem is not an option. It is also not necessary. Laudato Si helps us find that rugged grit and tenacious hope within ourselves and at Loyola. The real question, you see, is where are you at in all this? Here at Loyola, we have a vital role to play in finding the path forward, and we are already doing so much. Now is the time to make sure that we leave no stone unturned. That everything about this place and our work together is both sustainable and that it puts justice seeking and solidarity with the poor at the forefront of our curriculum, our programs, our policies, and yes, our investments. We're living history. So what are some practical suggestions? First of all, and Aaron Durval and the people from the Office of Sustainability can help you with this, assess your own carbon footprint, and then think about what you might do to reduce its weight. Now that you're starting to learn about these issues, or maybe you know a lot already, keep talking relentlessly with friends, peers, families, co-workers, neighbors, professors, members in your congregation or place of worship. Connect with others at Loyola. You are so not alone. We have the Office of Sustainability, the Institute of Environmental Sustainability. We have faculty across this entire university and all three campuses who are deeply concerned and engaged in this issue. Work with them, find them, email me. I will tell you where they are, but you can also email others. The Student Environmental Alliance is doing much important work. You'll see them throughout today and especially at the teach-in this afternoon. Also, get online. Of course, you're always online. So go to 350.org. Connect with them on Facebook, the Sierra Club, the Nature Conservancy. Also, there's organizations of faith, Catholic Climate Covenant, Interfaith Power and Light, that's an interfaith organization. Green Faith is ecumenical. I should have put them on the slide. Did you hear that? Green Faith, Interfaith Power and Light, Catholic Climate Covenant. Together, we can advocate for policy changes that none of us can enact alone. So let your legislators and religious leaders, your teachers and administrators know that you expect strong leadership now. Be a part of the grassroots efforts leading up to the December Climate Summit in Paris. Be an agent of change. Now, we can't leave it all to Pope Francis or to the other rock stars that we love to remember. You see, Pope Francis can't lead if we don't walk with him. Martin Luther King Jr. could not have done what he did for civil rights had it not been for the people. We think of him as the man of the year, but look at the march in Washington. Would not have been news if all of those people hadn't shown up. Ordinary people make movements. This was the climate march last September in New York. Ordinary people give these movements breath, legs, and power. Another way to put this is from theologian Frederick Buechner. He wrote, "The place God calls you is to the place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet." Find that place. Dwell in it with all your heart, mind, and soul. Pope Francis is asking us, in short, to find our own inner rock stars, to stand shoulder to shoulder with him. So I leave you not with his image, but of that of another different kind of prophetic voice. Know this guy? The Lorax? Yes, I still go to children's movies because I have a son. But not only that, this is actually the new Lorax. The original Lorax looked like this, from 1971. In 1971, before most of us had given a second thought to the health of our planet, and I realize many of us had not even been born yet who are in this room, Dr. Seuss, a Lutheran, by the way, put it succinctly, unless someone like you cares a whole awful lot, nothing's going to get better. It's not. It's not enough to be a fan. It's not enough to just say, isn't Pope Francis cool? It's not enough to wait for that next heavy hitter to make the changes that this world needs. And yet, even as I say that, I dare you to be inspired by Pope Francis. I dare you to let him entice you to fall in love for the first time or again with the immense beauty of our common home and of one another. Together with God's grace and love, we can. We absolutely can meet the challenges that we face. Thank you.
If you have a chair that's open or you can squeeze in, we'd be much obliged. Put your hand up for a chair near you. Yeah, thanks. Go ahead.
If you happen to be here for my class, there's a sign-up sheet in the back. Just guessing.
Now, there's a lot more seats right down here in the front. Thank you very much, Dr. Vigen, for a very motivational talk. It's also very incisive in its ability to look into what we're currently facing, in which the encyclical certainly calls us to pay heed to. Thank you very much for that. We're going to have a discussion period after all three papers are presented. So we're going to save questions till that point. So if you have some based on the first presentation, write them down. Don't forget them. We will have a chance to discuss and expand the conversation here in a few minutes. I want to move, though, to our second speaker to give plenty of time. Dr. Sandra Sullivan-Dunbar is an assistant professor of Christian ethics here in the theology department at Loyola. Her work focuses on feminist ethics, sexual ethics, and Christian social ethics. She's been actively involved in discussions about sustainable investment policies at Loyola as well. So why don't we welcome her, and let's look forward to what she has to give to us.
I want to echo all of the thanks that have gone before me to all of the organizers, especially Michael Murphy. Thank you for putting this together, and I'm so thrilled with the turnout we have. Thank you all for coming as well. When Michael Murphy asked me to speak on chapter 2, which is kind of the theological heart of the encyclical, I think, and then I went back and I reread it and I mulled over, I started to think, oh no, I'm going to have to talk about contraception. And so I say that because I will be talking a little bit about contraception, not as an attempt to hijack a conversation about the environment to talk about an issue in sexual ethics, but because I actually think there are so deeply linked, and that the themes in chapter 2 about the place of humanity inside of overall creation and our use of technology and human responsibility, you cannot talk about those issues without also talking about the contraceptive teachings of the church. So I will launch into actual reading now, though. In the second chapter of Laudato Si, the Gospel of Creation, Pope Francis delves with sensitivity and nuance into a set of questions about the particular place of human persons within God's good creation. In keeping with the overall emphasis of the encyclical, Francis emphasizes the interconnectedness of all parts of creation, including human persons. Yet, in keeping with long Catholic tradition, he also wants to emphasize the special dignity of human persons within this immensely diverse and glorious creation. While these two emphases may seem to stand in a certain tension with one another, I believe a theology of creation is possible that can hold them simultaneously without one trumping the other. In this chapter, and even more so in the third chapter, Francis, like other popes before him, affirms technology as an expression of human creativity and agency, while arguing that technology is not intrinsically good. Our usage of technology must reflect a careful balance between creative agency and humble restraint that mirrors the balance between our interdependence with creation and our unique place within it. In their moral teachings, and particularly in sexual ethics, but arguably also in their social ethics, recent popes have emphasized human uniqueness to the point of trumping our profound continuity with and interdependence with the rest of creation. Pope Francis in Laudato Si moves farther toward a genuine integration of these two emphases, but I don't think he gets all the way there. Toward the end of my presentation, I will suggest that to hold together Francis's account of the profound interconnection of all created things with the uniquely human capacity to intervene and shape creation through moral agency and technology requires a revision in church teaching on at least one particular form of technology, that of contraception. Moreover, though Francis himself does not appear to be seeking resources to rethink the church's moral guidance on contraception, several of the themes of his own encyclical, when taken together, may provide steps on this path. Francis offers us a beautiful account of the Roman Catholic theology of creation, grounded in scripture and in the thought of Thomas Aquinas. As he notes in paragraph 77, Genesis depicts that the world came about as the result of a decision, not chaos or chance. Creation is of the order of love. God's love is the fundamental moving force in all created things. In this creation, God is intimately present to each being, and all creation manifests God's presence, even while God remains transcendent. As human persons, when we recognize both God's intimate closeness to creation and God's transcendence and power, we are better able to accept our own appropriate place within the created order, rather than striving for domination. Our appropriate place does involve taking responsibility, using our creativity, and developing and using technology, but all of these exercises of our unique human capacities must be tempered by an awareness of our status as creatures and of the intrinsic and not simply utilitarian value of creation. These are not new themes in Catholic social thought, but Francis adds some particular emphases. First, Francis is quite descriptive about the cycle of life and death involved in nature. For example, in his first chapter, he observes, "It is hard for us to accept that the way natural ecosystems work is exemplary. Plants synthesize nutrients, which feed herbivores. These, in turn, become food for carnivores, which produce significant quantities of organic waste, which give rise to a new generation of plants. This is a creation in which living things feed off of each other. Life and death are intertwined. This interdependence of creatures and of life and death does not negate God's love for every creature. As Francis says, even the fleeting life of the least of beings is the object of God's love, and in its few seconds of existence, God enfolds it with his affection." Secondly, Francis emphasizes that every created thing has intrinsic value. All of creation finds its final end in God. Though human beings may have reason to use aspects of creation to eat, or to mine, or to build, created things do not exist only for our use. Francis also asserts, in keeping with long Roman Catholic tradition, that human persons nevertheless have a unique dignity among all created things. Francis insists on this even as he references evolution as the process that generated human beings as well as other living species. He argues that evolution alone cannot explain the emergence of a personal being within a material universe. This emergence, he says, presupposes a direct action of God and a particular call to life and relationship on the part of a thou who addresses another thou. A third notable feature of Francis' discussion of nature is his emphasis on fragility, balance, and equilibrium. These elicit human responsibility for protection. Francis asserts, human beings endowed with intelligence must respect the laws of nature and the delicate equilibria existing between the creatures of the world. I find the inclusion of these two phrases, laws of nature and delicate equilibria, within the same sentence to be quite striking and suggestive. Usually in Catholic moral theology, the laws of nature are understood in terms of a very particular teleology. Teleology, for those who don't know, means a movement towards an end that God has sort of ordained for something. We are not to block a particular creature or process from achieving its God-given end. By speaking in terms of equilibrium, Francis implicitly references a teleology of the whole, which takes up within itself the present survival of some creatures and the death of others. In this vision, the world cannot contain too many of any one type of creature at any given time. Such would upset the equilibrium. This holistic teleology is not novel. It is espoused by Thomas Aquinas, who sees it as fully compatible with a more particular teleology of individual creatures. But it does not sit well with the very strong emphasis on procreation within Catholic sexual ethics, at least not at the present time when population is growing very quickly, at a rate which outpaces resources. If, in fact, we are so deeply interconnected with the rest of creation, our responsibility for protecting a fragile ecosystem, for guarding an equilibrium in which the whole can flourish, would seem to require thoughtful, responsible restraints on our own rates of reproduction. Francis asserts that demographic growth is fully compatible with an integral and shared development. I am sorry to directly contradict a pope, but this is simply not correct. Though it is true that overconsumption by the wealthy has a greater relative impact on environmental destruction than does population growth per se, it is also the case that population growth does have an impact, and we really are at a point at which we cannot allow things to get any worse. The realities of climate change in particular require a rapid and dramatic shift toward reducing greenhouse gases. Francis hints that we may be in very deep trouble indeed in Laudato Si, but he may still fall short of articulating the true measure of our danger. Francis is concerned that we understand that technology is not morally neutral. It may be used for good or ill. Some forms of technology are likely to increase human flourishing and the sustainability of ecosystems. Other forms are likely to bring harm. Technology is an expression of human creativity and the desire to make things better for ourselves and others. It can go wrong if we objectify the rest of creation and think of it as available solely for our own self-interested manipulation. In addition, our technology has given us a great deal of power, and I think it's interesting that Francis says it is extremely risky for a small part of humanity to have it. But some technologies can be used for great good. As he puts it, no one is suggesting we go back to the Stone Age. Technology has a place. In papal writings, contraception has frequently been framed as a technology that objectifies persons in particular. I want to suggest that it can be the opposite. It can be one of those technologies that humanizes us, that allows us to meet our profoundly human responsibility to foster equilibrium in the ecosystem. In light of our profound interdependence with other creatures, emphasized by Francis, in light of the need for an equilibrium, in light of the high demand for resources made on the ecosystem by a species such as Homo sapiens, in light of our unique capacities for responsible stewardship, contraceptive technology, at least some forms of it, seems an essential element of contemporary human moral agency. I've taught the encyclical reaffirming the church teaching against contraception, Humana Vitae, many times. In fact, I will leave from this panel today and teach it to my graduate course in Christian sexual ethics. Those who are familiar with the logic of the encyclical know that the teaching rests on the view that a particular type of technology, contraceptive technology, violates the movement of natural processes in a way that is always morally wrong. The very simple technology of a condom, for example, blocks sperm from meeting egg, and this, it is argued, divides the unitive from the procreative ends of sexual intercourse. Technology frequently contradicts natural conditions, and this is not always considered morally wrong. As my own first professor of moral theology asked, and he was a Jesuit, why does a condom violate a natural process while turning on the electric light after the sun goes down does not violate a natural process? Or as a perceptive undergraduate once asked, why is a condom a forbidden technology but the thermometer that a woman uses to determine whether she's ovulating so that she can avoid pregnancy not a forbidden technology? The only answer can be that the condom blocks a physical process associated with reproduction. This often criticized physicalist argument falters even more in light of Francis's reference to the responsible use of technology to protect equilibrium. Equilibrium is not served if this particular physical process reaches its end in all cases. Human persons, equipped with a relatively simple technology, can protect equilibrium through their cumulative decisions about the use of this technology in response to their individual situations and resources. The popes frequently express concern about state-sponsored programs of population control, and Francis echoes this. I do not support such programs, though I think that states should provide access to contraception. Contraceptive technology is not the sort of technology that can be concentrated in the hands of a few, and thus it cannot pose the danger that Francis warns against. It is a technology used in our most intimate relationships. The moral agency here exercised is a form of stewardship at a very personal level. It is, then, an expression of the Catholic principle of subsidiarity, of decision-making and responsible moral agency at the most local level possible and appropriate, and is supported and facilitated by higher levels of social organization where necessary. As Francis tells us several times in Laudato Si, there is reason for hope. We are made for love. We can use our moral agency for good. Local efforts around the world are creatively engaged in projects to increase sustainability and human flourishing. I suggest that we can consider the use of contraception among these efforts. In short, Francis has framed our human uniqueness as calling out a responsibility for the rest of creation. He has also emphasized the interconnectedness and interdependence of all creatures, an interdependence that can only be sustained if we maintain a certain equilibrium among creatures. This equilibrium is maintained in part by the cycle of different life forms consuming other life forms, and generating waste that becomes the ground still for more life. Human beings are a part of this web, and yet we are unique in this web, both in our capacity for personhood and in our ability to either destroy or protect the web of interconnection. All of these points are made by Francis. It would seem that the ban on contraception reflects a less nuanced theology than that of Francis, one that, for example, allows our human uniqueness to trump our connectedness to the rest of creation, rather than to exist in tandem with that connectedness. What Francis's theology of creation suggests, with its multiple emphases, is that human beings can exercise their uniquely human responsibility, can honor their particular place in the web of creation, precisely by developing and using technologies that protect this web, and particularly in ways that facilitate the widespread exercise of moral agency at the most local level possible. Rather than using our uniqueness as humans as a bar against any constraints on our proliferation, the implications of our uniqueness suggest that such constraints, generated through a multitude of local decisions, is a mark of our uniquely human responsibility to protect the planet. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's another provocative challenge in reading the encyclical, but also I really appreciate your taking the encyclical back into an already controversial and debated topic that needs to be addressed. We have many, many, let's say, little foods to think about there, foods for thought, to take into our discussion period, so let's keep that with us as we go into our final paper of this first session. Our next presenter, Michael Agliardo, is a member of the sociology department here at Loyola, as well as a Jesuit priest. In sociology, he focuses on environmental sociology, the sociology of religion, as well as the intersection of the two. He has researched Catholic women religious and their work on ecology, the involvement of the U.S. bishops in environmental issues in public life, and the contribution of the Catholic Church to the climate change debates. He's currently working with the Catholic Coalition on Climate Change to investigate the impact of this encyclical on the U.S. Church and the wider society. And today he will be offering us sort of a more or less sociological approach to his reading of the encyclical. So we'll welcome him today. And before we clap and welcome him, those of you who just came in the back, if you want, there are some seats up here in the front. Please, you're invited to come up here to the front. We'd love to have you. Come on in. Let's welcome Dr. Agliardo today.
Now, I've been asked to comment on chapter 3 of Laudato Si, which deals with technology. So we'll see how well I can work the technology here. Let's get this to work. Actually, I think Pope Francis does remind us that technology can come between people, can come between us and nature, can come between us and God. So I'd just like to begin by saying good morning to you all. And again, thank you to Dr. Murphy. And to our panelists for beginning, setting us off on a very provocative and interesting pace. Today, I gave a sort of subtitle to my own comments, Laudato Si, sociological insights and prophetic implications. As Colby mentioned, I'm a member of the sociology department, and I couldn't help noticing when I read Laudato Si that the entire document is laced with brilliant insights about the social world. So I began to think, well, you know, what if Pope Francis were here at Loyola University? What if he were, let's say, a grad student in one of our sociology seminars? And he had to turn in Laudato Si as his final paper. He would have done pretty well. You know, I'd give him like an A-. It's a very good paper, all right? Many people, when they hear about Laudato Si, when they've heard about it on the news, when they read about it in the newspapers, their impression is that it's an encyclical about doing something for the environment. It's a call to action to fix the planet. Right? And that's, in a sense, part of it. But in fact, there's a greater depth to the encyclical. Right? In fact, Pope Francis uses the occasion of our ecological woes to get us to think about far more than how we just fix the problems. He's asking us to really think about how we do society, how we do humanity. We're doing something wrong. So, what I'd like to focus on in reflecting on this third chapter, maybe using it as a springboard for some further thoughts, because there are many fine summaries of the document out there already, I'd like to reflect on how Francis is calling us to think about environmental problems not simply as failings that we have incurred as individuals. That's part of it. And Pope Francis does give us some good guidance on how we can reflect on our own individual ecological conversion. But at the same time, Pope Francis is asking us to think about what kind of society we want to create together. This kind of responsibility is a little bit more difficult to grasp and perhaps a little bit easier to evade. We attempted to take the way society works for granted. We're often, in fact, tempted to shrug it off. Say, well, this is the way the world works. It's too bad that people lost their jobs. It's too bad that they can't afford health care for their children. But those are the laws of economics. That's the way the world works. In sociology, we call this naturalizing the social world. Social Darwinism is a particularly nasty form of doing this. It's a way of evading responsibility for the kind of society that we all create. So, Pope Francis reminds us that, in fact, often how we see things reflects our own vested interests. We're often most able to shrug off the ills of society when they affect other people and not ourselves. But the Pope is calling us to take responsibility for the society that we have created together, especially if we are the ones who are benefiting from it. If we're participating in this situation that we are benefiting from, we cannot pretend not to take notice. We cannot pretend that the social situations that we participate in, the social arrangements that we participate in that benefit us, are not our own responsibility as well. So, Pope Francis reminds us that when we look at the world that we create, we have to take into account especially the plight of the poor. And he widens our horizon to take into account our planet, Sister Earth, as well. So I've been asked to comment on chapter 3, which has a rather interesting title, The Human Roots of the Ecological Crisis. That actually echoes a title of an essay written in 1967, which I will talk about. But before I launch into that, I just wanted to say, I really wanted to talk about chapter 4, which is integral ecology. Bill French got that one. But since I'm here before him, I may cut him off at the pass. I do have a few things to say about it. But anyway, as I mentioned, chapter 3 in Laudato Si echoes the title of an essay written in 1967 by a historian at UCLA named Lynn White. And that essay appeared in Science, and it was entitled The Historical Roots of Our Ecological Crisis. That's a very interesting essay, a very provocative one, because Lynn White, interestingly, in a certain sense, blamed Christianity for our ecological crisis. Christianity and Judaism, in a certain sense. And this is why. This is the argument that he made. He said, Christianity and Judaism treat God as transcendent. And therefore, they locate the sacred in some space beyond this world. And by doing so, Christianity and Judaism evacuate the sacred from our world. God is sacred. The world is just an object then. And once the world is reduced to an object, it can be a thing available for our exploitation. Interestingly, though, when you look at the Lynn White hypothesis from a sociological point of view, you ask the question, when, in fact, does the world really become an object? When do we really begin to look at the world as a thing, a mechanical system, something to be exploited? And that really is not when Judaism is on the scene, not in the medieval period, but in the early modern period, when science arises, when capitalism arises, when industry and technology arise, all these things which, in a certain sense, reduce the natural world to commodities. It's this mindset of seeing the natural world as an object for exploitation, seeing a forest as so much lumber, seeing the oceans as just a reservoir for food. It's this mindset that robs, as it were, nature of its sacredness, of its beauty, of its sanctity, of its integrity. Now, Lynn White recognizes that, in fact, those mindsets do come in the modern world. In fact, in the medieval period, people had a deeper sense of the sacred. In fact, they lived in much closer connection with nature. So in a certain sense, what he then says is that, well, these things, technology, science, capitalism, industrialization, those are in a certain sense the bastard children of Christianity, because they arose in the West in a very distinctive way and not other places in the world. That's worth thinking about. Maybe we can think of them as certain kind of Christian heresies, where a certain insight or truth gets exaggerated and becomes absolute, taken out of context. Well, anyway, Lynn White's indictment, though, of Christianity runs into a stumbling block that he himself recognizes, and is right there in the middle of his essay. And that stumbling block is the same figure that Pope Francis himself mentions in his essay, Laudato Si. That stumbling block is Francis of Assisi. Francis of Assisi, how could he have been a Christian in this sense when he saw himself as kin with all of nature? Not even just the living things in nature, but the elements like fire and wind. Well, Lynn White's response is that in fact, though the church didn't recognize it, it was Francis of Assisi who must have been heretical. Now, I lived with a fellow named Kenneth Himes, who himself is a Franciscan, and he says, no, actually, Francis of Assisi was rather quite Christian. Because he understood that all creation is kindred, it shares a bond. And in the Bible it says we are made of the soil of the earth. And that is precisely the insight that Francis lives out, the sense of connectedness. But actually, this statue of Francis is a brilliant statue. I took this picture when I went to the Green Mountain Monastery in Vermont. And you see there Francis, with all these birds flying around him. It's a brilliant statue because actually it's all one piece. You know, the birds are all connected and they're all resting on the edge of Francis's hands there. But it creates this illusion of them being separate. But interestingly, and this is the great insight, they're all connected. Anyway, chapter 3 of Francis's encyclical is essentially an indictment of technology, or of what he calls the kind of technological mindset. But in fact, interestingly, he begins by praising technology. He says that it can do wonderful things. It can even bring people together. Again, the problem is the use that we put technology to. And when we adopt the mindset, a technological mindset, a kind of what he calls an epistemological paradigm of power and control, when we adopt the illusion that we are masters of the world and we deserve to be those masters, that's what he is concerned about when technology runs amok. And so it's the technological paradigm and its other manifestations, the capitalist paradigm run amok, where capitalism as a system with profit as its motive and goal becomes absolutized and runs over other things and other considerations. And what Francis would say is that we always have to take responsibility for capitalism, for any system that we put in place, so that those systems serve human ends. They don't just run on their own. We're responsible for how they operate. We have to rein them back in take into account some larger vision. So the problem is not technology, but technology run amok. What Francis says is, the technological paradigm has become so dominant that it would be difficult to do without its resources, and even more difficult to utilize them without being dominated by their internal logic. There's a logic, then, in our use of technology that comes to pervade our lives, our world, and interestingly, our very selves. And this is kind of the interesting paradox. Francis points out that our use of technology can actually change our world and ourselves. And that's most likely when we're focusing on technology and on the objects that it controls, and we don't step back and think reflexively about what this does to us. What do we become? How do we change ourselves by the way that we use technology? What kind of society do we create when we're so busy focusing on what technology can do that we don't pay attention to what it does to us? So again, this is a brilliant insight which Francis stole from us sociologists. So I'd like to point out a classic work in sociology, the Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism, written by one of the great classical founders of our discipline, Max Weber. There are a lot of nuances to this hypothesis, but what I'll just focus on here is Weber's insight that once capitalism is created in the modern world, it's sort of like a machine that once built now runs on its own. In fact, he compares capitalism to an iron cage, because we human beings have built this system and now it enslaves, it imprisons us. Now, many people who read the Protestant Ethic thesis, who read this book, The Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism, miss the point. They argue that Weber is giving credit to Protestantism and to the trajectory of Christianity for creating the modern world. What he's pointing out, though, is that the systems of the modern world, like capitalism, like bureaucracy, like laws that don't take justice into account, but just operate impersonally on their own, that these things can enslave the very people that they were built to serve. So that's what the Protestant Ethic thesis points us to, how the systems that we build can fail to serve human ends and can in fact enslave us. So way back in 1905, Max Weber had this to say: this capitalist order is now bound to the technical and economic conditions of machine production, which today determine the lives of all the individuals who are born into this mechanism with irresistible force. Perhaps it will so determine them, so determine us, until the last ton of fossilized coal is burnt. So Max Weber wrote this back in 1905, saying that we have created this system that even if we can see the dangers of it, like climate change, that we may not be able to stop this system. That's a pretty frightening thought, isn't it? Can we stop this system? Can we do something about it? Well, in fact, Francis reminds us that the market is not an absolute, that we don't have to naturalize these systems, that we don't have to just lie over dead and say that's the way the world works. We don't have to say that human beings are just so much collateral damage quote passage 123 of our economic system, that the environment has to be snuffed out because of it. And so Francis's solution is something he calls integral ecology. Integral ecology ain't just about plants. In other words, what Francis wants us to think about is how the social world is connected back up with the natural world. Now, in fact, again, Francis is basically cribbing from a few sociologists, maybe stated a little more eloquently, but there are other people, for example, a fellow like Murray Bookchin, who argued for a way of thinking that he called social ecology, that the way we do society cannot fail to take into account the natural world, that we have to build society with nature and our relationship with nature, taking that into account. The Frankfurt School, Herbert Marcuse, all these people too remind us that the way we treat nature is paralleled often by the way we treat other human beings. And there's a link there. That capitalism exploits both nature and human beings. We have to move to a non-exploitative way of being and doing. Interestingly, classic American environmentalism failed to make this connection between society and nature. In its early stages, American environmentalism was about saving nature, as if nature were something out there, saving species and so forth. It failed to think through the deep connections between human beings and nature. Francis wants us to make that connection again with his integral ecology. Right. So that's why he doesn't want us to fall back on a technological fix. Technology got us into this mess, or the technological mindset of control and domination got us into this mess, because when we're controlling this or that thing, we fail to take into account the larger whole that we're all a part of, that we don't have control over, but that we participate in. So Francis wants us not to simply adopt one more technological fix, as if more technology were going to solve the problem. He wants us to do something a little bit deeper and more profound. He wants us to connect our human existence back up with our natural existence. And interestingly, even sociology forgot about making these connections. In its early days, sociology treated the social world as the product of social relations and having effect on other social relations, as if the natural world were just a kind of backdrop for the drama of society. And now, sociologists themselves are realizing that they have to take the natural world back into account when they do sociology. So we have one of the great environmental sociologists, Riley Dunlap, pointed out that there should be this thing called the new ecological paradigm that we think through on a deep level. It's very hard for sociologists to figure out how to integrate nature back into how we do sociology. So maybe, in fact, we sociologists could learn a thing or two from Pope Francis. In fact, maybe I'll even raise Pope Francis' grade. So, in our tradition, the classical sociological tradition, there are three greats: Max Weber, Karl Marx, and Emil Durkheim. Or perhaps we can now add Pope Francis. Thank you all.
All right. Take a second here for some adjustment for students who need to get out. And for those coming in, we have some seats that have opened up here. I invite you to come forward and fill them as you need to. We have some time for discussion, and I have a microphone. I'm assuming, for the sake of recording, that I should go out and have whoever's asking questions on a microphone. Yes?
We have microphones.
We have one ready to go?
Yeah.
Great. Okay. So when you have a question or a comment for discussion, raise your hand and we'll have someone come to you. And we'll go ahead and begin this. Many interesting connections, especially on last paper on technology, to the paper before that Dr. Sullivan-Dunbar was addressing. The issue of technology is one that comes up repeatedly in the encyclical, and is certainly something we need to think about in this day and age of rapidly increasing use of technology, sometimes without restraint or without much thought behind it. So let's go ahead and begin the discussion here. Dr. Lupieri has a question right here. Guy?
Thank you so much for all of you. I have 2 points for Father Agliardo. When I was reading the Laudato Si, I found really striking, and I think this is in symphony with what you said, that the Pope is quoting official document by the church, official documents by the church, bishops, etc., from the 80s and the 90s, that were already telling, look, things are going so bad, we have to quickly anything, things will be worse. Did anyone listen to them? So what are we doing? Is there a mediatic blackout? If it is true what I read, I think 10 or 12 days ago, I think in the New York Times, it said that in this country, 6 out of 10 Catholics do not know that the Pope published the Laudato Si. I have difficulty in believing that, but maybe it's true. So if we want that our effort are effective, we have to break through this mediatic blackout, but which is extremely difficult because maybe the media are controlled exactly by those powerful whatever corporations, I don't know, that are the major responsible for destroying the environment. And then, yes, this country is rightly famous for grassroots movements, but if we do not reach a level of the political circus and we cannot break through it, yes, Martin Luther King made it, but what can we do? I don't know. There are so many young people here. I'm so happy to see them. Most of us are American citizens. Are you going to vote at the next elections? And are you going to look at the programs of the candidates? What are they thinking for about ecological issues? Can we try to do something in that thing, in that direction? As a sociologist, do you have the magic solution in your pocket?
We'll say yes, I'm sure.
Yes. No. One of the things that's interesting to point out, of course, when a papal document is published, when the conferences write papers, the question is what happens with them. If there's a line here or a line there, it doesn't immediately transmit itself into the minds of the 1 billion or so Catholics who are on the planet, or all the other people who are here. And in fact, if you look at the history of the environmental movement in the United States, and the religious communities in the United States, from the 70s on through the early 80s, there was kind of a disjuncture between the two. Many of the religious groups were concerned with social justice. And they saw environmentalism as a distraction from that concern because it was focusing on plants and animals, and it wasn't integrated. They thought, we don't have the luxury to think about those sorts of things when people are dying in El Salvador, the human rights violations, and there's an arms race, and so forth, and so on. So there was a disjuncture in both communities. And in the end, it was the religious community in America which highlighted what we call the environmental injustices in America. That it's poor communities that suffer most of the environmental bads, and that had to be integrated into the environmental movement. And that was part of the increasing dialogue between the religious communities and the environmental movement, which at first were going on parallel tracks. I mean, I was even
I will recall when I was at Boston College in maybe 2007, 2008, I lived with a number of renowned theologians who were very much at the forefront of social justice issues, and they paid very little attention to environmental issues because they saw that as a kind of a distraction. At the same time, the environmental community was incensed about humani vitae, and they thought that population was the bugaboo of all bugaboos when it came to environmental issues. So for that reason, there was very little dialogue. And so that dialogue has increased, but it's more recent, the late 80s for the Protestants, beginning in the 90s with the Vatican and the Conference of Bishops here in the United States. But even with this document, Laudato Si, you say, why don't people know about it? Well, they need not just the Pope to publish something, but they also need for the church here in America to talk about it. And unfortunately, the church here in America has been a little slow on the uptake. Some bishops have had other priorities, and they're moving on this, but some are moving actually quite slow. I don't know if anybody else wants to say something.
Just very quickly, I think it's imperative that we not give power to a way that we have. Each of us who is registered to vote can vote, and we can all contact local religious leaders, local political leaders, regional, national. You know, there were, I think we got to what, how many thousands were in New York last November for the march?
400,000.
The Pope is addressing the joint session of Congress on the 24th of September. There have been critical times in history when huge groundswells of people have changed things that we thought were impossible to change. Slavery being one of them, Jim Crow being another, apartheid being another. This is such a time. So we have to simply show up and not wait for the Pope or anyone else to do all the work for us. All we need is a critical mass.
Okay, Dr. Hocker has a question here. We have a...
Yeah, very quickly. Two questions. First of you, let's not make a mistake. In this third chapter, Francis is calling for a cultural revolution. And I want to confront you with a criticism or critique of this capitalism bashing that is going on there and technology bashing that is going on there. How would you respond to that? Overdoes he his argument in this chapter or overall in this encyclical letter? Or are we called to end the capitalism as we know it or have known it for the last 200 years or so? Because if so, then we have to articulate it exactly in that way. And I think Pope Francis doesn't shy away from this message. It is a cultural revolution. It is a revolution. It's not my word, it is his word. So from a sociological perspective, how would you actually respond to that? And my second point is, you know, I agree with you in general on the contraceptives issue, but I do not agree with you in inserting it here. Overpopulation or population growth is certainly a big problem here, but it can also be used very, very easily ideologically, pointing at these countries who have great or big population growth excuses us from doing all the other things. And that has been an ideological use of ideology that is very, very well known from the 1960s and the 1970s, where we have seen that already. And it is actually consistent in the social ethics teaching of the Catholic Church not to fall into that trap. So I would rather distinguish the question of let's say, rights to access to, call it technologies or means, and quality of life, and Francis has a lot to say about that, and using the population growth as an ideological argument within this debate. And I acknowledge what you wanted to say, and rightly so, that yes, population growth does actually add to the climate crisis.
Okay, so the first.
Okay. Actually, within sociology, there is a debate about whether or not capitalism has to be overthrown, or whether it can be rehabilitated, whether it can be made to serve human and ecological ends. So the theorists who work on the idea that capitalism can be rehabilitated, they cite Europe, the greening of industry there, that governments can put in place environmentally sound regulations. Germany is constantly cited as a success story in many different ways. And this theory is called ecological modernization theory, that we can reflect on our circumstances intelligently and adapt capitalism and the tremendous power that capitalism has. It's an incredibly dynamic system. Sometimes it's called an engine of progress, sometimes it's called a juggernaut that runs people over. But it has a tremendous dynamism in it. Can we control that, as it were, for the good? Just like the question of the atom. You know, can we control nuclear energy for the good, or will it destroy us? So this is one of the big debates. The majority of people, environmental sociologists that I know, think that ecological modernization theory is wishful thinking. That they think that we need a much deeper fix. Right? So that's the debate going on there. I don't know that Pope Francis resolves it on all the different levels, but he at least calls us to think about how the system cannot be naturalized, that it has to serve higher ends, that we can't just take it for granted. Right? Capitalism was built as a system in a particular way. Right? It didn't just fall out of the sky. It hasn't always been here.
Okay. I don't bring up contraception out of a, I guess the first thing I would say in response, Hilla, is I don't think that just because an issue has been used ideologically in the past, you're there, okay. It is a reason to avoid talking about it when it's the elephant in the room. And to me, if you're in this chapter, what I see is the foundational theological issues that Francis is approaching, as his predecessors have approached, but I think he does it in a better way, are interconnectedness with creation and human uniqueness in the context of that interconnectedness, which raises the third issue that goes into chapter 3 of technology. Because part of what it means to be unique in this creation is that we are also participating in the creative process with our ingenuity. Those are foundational issues, and as I read it, I cannot, I can't read that without, I think that those three issues come together also in church teaching on sexuality, and specifically the specific way that the argument about contraception is constructed, and it's impossible not to talk about them together for me. I think it's also sort of impossible for Pope Francis not to talk about them together, because of course he has to have references to, we can't have a, we shouldn't get all worried about population growth, et cetera. And I think he needs to be challenged when he says that. He's saying that in a way to cover up the fact, I think, that those three things together, thinking about our interconnectedness, our uniqueness, and our need to figure out a responsible use of technology, or perhaps a responsible way to navigate something like capitalism, is connected to issues of sexuality and reproduction, how many of us there are. The other thing that it's connected to, I think, is I think if there is a solution to any of these problems that Michael is talking about, systems kind of controlling us instead of controlling them, it is going to come down to agency at a local level, whether that means small, sustainable capitalist enterprises, or whether it means decision-making in local communities about how many people can we, in our community, how many people can we bring into personhood and human flourishing without destroying the environment around us and without being harming them, without them being deeply harmed as well. That hope that was a relatively coherent response.
Let's take a second here for those who are just coming in. Why don't you come up here and find a seat? We have plenty of seats.
I might just add a brief note on the question of contraception too, in the sense that in sociology, the concern about birth control was a big issue 20, 25, 30 years ago. But now it's often recognized for its racist roots. That the person who wrote the population bomb, Paul Ehrlich, who was concerned about overpopulation, was an entomologist. All right, as an insect scientist. So his understanding of human population was affected by his study of other species. And right now in today's world, population is only increasing in a few places. Right? Most of those are not Catholic places. Okay, and in fact, in Europe, there is great fear of population decline. Eastern Europe in particular. So the population question is a complex one, and the issue seems to have to do more with ideology of control over women, empowerment of women, education, and so forth, and not just a technological fix. Maybe I would say that.
Okay. We have a question right here. Let's
thank you. My question is that how can economic interests meet environmental challenges in the global economy? Currently, we have Russia now increasing numerous shifts in the Arctic Circle, and I was just wondering how can viability meet sustainability?
Good question. Someone pick that up?
Well, I'll give a stab.
Yeah.
Great question, because that's where the rubber hits the road, right? So I'm not an economist, but I do think that if we could subsidize fossil fuels less and incentivize renewable energy sources more, that would really be helpful. Why keep giving tax breaks to an industry that is in an economy that is dead, that we can no longer sustain? And we have already seen, there was a great article just this week in New York Magazine, I think, on all the kinds of green energy growth sectors that are, you know, working with drought-intensive environments, wind, solar, not depleting natural water resources the way fracking does, and they're taking off. They could use more structural support. We don't need to give the same tax subsidies and tax credits. The real cost of fuel and oil is much higher than we realize because it is so heavily subsidized with taxpayer dollars. So that's one piece of the puzzle. And I'm sure there are others, and I might think of others, but that's the one thing I for sure want to say. Does anybody else want to jump in?
I think that the subsidies are something like $10 million a minute to the fossil fuel industry. So just to back up what Dr. Vigen was saying about that, I don't think I have anything particular to add to.
Well, I will point out that in Europe, in fact, BP and Shell have recognized that we have to move to a non-fossil fuel-based economy. Even BP and Shell have. Right? But in this country, there is actually a denial industry that think tanks and a few rogue scientists are funded by a few powerful interests. And these powerful interests are actually scared. Because, in fact, renewables are that close to being economically viable.
Well, they are in many cases.
All right, that if the balance were shifted, it would mean that the investments that some people have made in fossil fuel, in refineries, and all these things would go to waste. Because it wouldn't be economically viable anymore. That's how close we are. And there's a sociologist at Yale, Justin Farrell, who has done a study through networking analysis and shown how all of these think tanks and scientists and so forth all connect back up to two sources, ExxonMobil and the Koch brothers.
I wanted to say, too, that on this point that we have we need batteries, right? So a key area of development is the battery and how to store energy and different kind. And we had a great speaker at our climate conference last spring on that very point. But the idea is, this is where I do believe technology and innovation, this is what made America great. We sent people to the moon. If we did that, then businesses absolutely, and they can profit at the same time. I think Dr. Tuckman is here, our founding director of the Institute of Sustainability. Do you have anything to add about industry, green industries, that we should absolutely hear from? Because this is supposed to be a dialogue, a teach-in. I'm not putting you on the spot, but I mean, I did.
I actually think you guys are doing a
okay.
Terrific job.
But you should know that we have a lot of people at IES, right? That, but did you want, no, oh, you're done?
No, okay. I think you guys have it.
There's a microphone right there if you want to.
So that's the beginning.
Several hands over here. We have a question.
Thanks. I'm Ben Johnson from the History Department. I really appreciate this panel. I think it goes to show how the seemingly sort of isolated, particularly environmental question of global climate change is in fact connected to so many things, from questions of sexuality and reproduction, questions of our own views and understandings of nature, to the kind of big questions about capitalism that we've started to discuss here. So I guess that leads me both to a comment and a question. You know, I guess the comment is that I do think it's a big mistake to dismiss the calls for population control and birth control as I think it's a mistake to dismiss them as unconnected to these things. And I think that the kind of work that development economists have done in the last generation, particularly at Columbia University's Jeffrey Sachs, which has really brought in environmental questions fundamentally to the heart of questions of economic development, but he's also brought in questions of reproduction, questions of the status of women. And it's not just on the sort of large global level with questions like climate change that these things matter, but also in terms of local environmental degradation and the kind of things that cause people to move. So I think that our colleagues point that this is an unavoidable. It's an issue that I think for various reasons the church wants to avoid, or that Francis wants to avoid at least right now, but in the end it's an unavoidable one. So that, I guess, is my comment. The question that I wanted to ask gets us back to the question of politics, right? And that is that, you know, it's an inescapable one, I think, right? And by politics I mean formal electoral politics and policy making. And what I appreciate about the Pope's encyclical and about this panel is that we don't start there, right? We start with questions of human values. We start with questions of social justice. But the fact is, if there's going to be any effective remediation of questions of climate change, there has to be not only the kind of changes in consciousness and awareness that we've talked about and local changes, but there has to be some kind of global regime of regulation of carbon. And the main barrier to the, and people have been trying this, right, since Kyoto, and what was Kyoto in 1988? Is that possible? 97. Anyway, a long time ago, so long ago that I can't remember exactly when it was. And there's one major obstacle, one of the major obstacles to such a regime is the United States, which has refused to do that. And a principal reason for that is, you know, both the kind of industries that you were just discussing, but also since the 90s, one of the major institutions in American political life, and there's no way to say this that doesn't sound partisan, the Republican Party has moved to a point where you cannot be a serious person in the Republican Party without standing up in front of the microphones and denying the existence of climate change, or coming up with some convoluted formulation that essentially does that while trying to alienate as few people as possible. So I guess this is turning into a statement, statement rather than a question, but I mean, I think that's a huge problem, right? And it's, for some reason, it doesn't seem to be a problem in most of the rest of the world, in the sense that, like, if you take conservatives in Europe, you know, Christian Democrats in Germany, they have the same basic ideological commitments as most people who vote Republican in the United States, and yet they seem willing to address climate change. So I guess my question is, in what ways can we as Americans, in what ways can the Catholic Church, in what ways can the moment that's been opened by this papal encyclical make it possible for us to address that problem, which is one that absolutely has to be addressed?
huge issue. You may want to field them.
Is this one working?
Yeah.
Yes, that's
yeah.
Okay. And the first thing that pops into my mind is actually, it's not directly, but it actually is fairly closely related to politics. An element in the sort of political evolution that you've been talking about is also conservative evangelical Christians and some Catholic Christians too. It's been shown that they're, when they hear about climate change, they filter that that issue through their theological beliefs in these ways. It's frequently climate change denial, which is fed then by certain political discourses in our country, is rooted in the idea that God is in charge, that if you interview people, they will say, God wouldn't let that happen. For us to say that we're heating up the world is actually kind of prideful, and when you reframe that in terms of human sinfulness, there's often a shift in the way that, in people's ability to take in the fact that we actually are harming the planet. So one thing I would say is that as a theologian, I would like to be able to help people think differently about it theologically, whether that's in a parish or in my classroom. And I would hope that that's one of the things that we're trying to accomplish for people. So,
okay. Just quickly, there are ecological conservative Christians. There are, like Rick Warren, Saddleback Church, there is a conservative evangelical and ecological movement. But beyond that, some of you are new or here when I was talking before. Write these names down. Catholic Climate Covenant. Interfaith Power and Light, Green Faith, 350.org, the Sierra Club, the Nature Conservancy. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. There are strong grassroots organizations that are working at getting out information, spreading awareness, getting out the vote. And it takes our bodies. This is not just an intellectual project. That is why I talk so much about emotion. We have got to have our hearts and bodies invested, and that's why the teach-in today, where there's going to be places to sign up with the Student Environmental Alliance and such, are so important. This is just the beginning of action. Once you know, now what are you going to do?
We should do, I get a lot of questions, though.
I was just going to say, I do think that well, I'm a sociologist of religion, so I like to think that religious ideas do have an impact on how people see all kinds of things like environmental issues and so forth. But sometimes the road there is rather complex. And the problem with climate change is that it has become politicized. And by that, I mean that it has become a political football that's being thrown back and forth between the Democratic and Republican parties. The Democratic Party believes in climate change, so the Republican Party has this response that it doesn't. Or climate change is associated with Barack Obama, who is trying to do things about it, but he's the same guy who put in place this health mandate. And so if he's for it, we have to be against it. So again, that's a kind of politicization. It has nothing to do with the intrinsic merit of the issue. It has to do with what's going to get you in office, how you build alliances and so forth. This is the only country where there is a sustained block of people who are even highly educated, who think that climate change is just something made up, right? Because they seize on what these fake think tanks have pumped out and so forth. Right? This is the only place on the planet where you see such sustained climate denial. But watch tomorrow. Tomorrow, I'm told that in the House of Representatives, a congressman from upstate New York, a Republican, will introduce a resolution that we should at least begin to talk about climate change.
Wow.
And we're trying to get somebody, a Republican senator or two, to do the same thing.
We're running short on time, so we're going to wrap this up soon. Instead of maybe answering questions, I would like, because it's the first session as well, maybe we could hear a few questions. And we may or may not have time to answer them, but maybe we can let them resonate through the rest of the day. So I know there were several hands on the front. We have one here, and if there are other hands, and one over here, maybe let's just hear some of these questions and some of the thoughts that are provoking the audience. So let's go ahead and start here.
Well, my question is about grassroots movements, and I'm most of the kids here are too young to remember when we first inaugurated Earth Day. And my kids were so excited. It was such a great celebration. How do we get that back in the schools? I mean, would that be a great start? Because, you know, the Pope and I, we're aging. We've got to rein in these young kids. Sunday, I was walking along the lakefront, and there's a blue trash can there, but yet there are 35 plastic bottles on the ground. This is an educational issue. We've got to start educating our kids at a very young age, and I think that's going to get great things for us back then.
Okay, over here. Got
I would just want to make a couple of comments. I work with a couple of local organizations, Chicago Area Peace Action, the People's Lobby. We've been very active with the Sierra Club, 350.org. I would encourage us to remember that leadership comes from the bottom up, and we must do a whole lot more than vote. Illinois, we have this really exciting opportunity in Illinois to make a difference in carbon emissions. We have three bills, energy bills, pending in Springfield. Two of them are horrific, and one of them is not perfect, but it's pretty darn good, and it would incentivize renewable energy. We actually wrote to Archbishop Supish about this, and we said we really must not squander this opportunity in Illinois. And we got a letter of response. It was so exciting. So we're hopeful that we're going to be able to work along with the Archdiocese on that. And just a couple of other quick things. There is a new documentary that everybody should see. Show it to your students, show it in your libraries, show it in your churches. It's called Call of Life, Facing the Mass Extinction. And it follows the encyclical beautifully, just beautifully, in terms of the ecology, you know, issues. It also addresses the population issue. We sent that to Archbishop Supish, and we got a nice response from him. It was timely. I would encourage you to see it. It's wonderful material. And then lastly, you know, I worked for Obama twice to get him elected. But he's a politician, and his visit this past week to Alaska, I could be going out on a limb here because I didn't see a lot of the news, but I think it was more of a geopolitical visit than it was one of concern for climate warming. If you have a minute, look at Michael Clare's last book. The first chapter addresses everything that's going on in the Arctic, and he wrote this book in 12. Michael Clare is talking about all those resources in the Arctic need to stay there. The Russians shouldn't exploit it, we should not exploit it, etc. So, you know, the leadership has to come from us. We have to call our representatives, we have to learn to lobby them, and we can make a big difference, and we only have a short window of opportunity for mitigation. Thank you.
Thank you. And we have one last question, which will just resonate as well.
My question is, how do green technologies step outside of the technocratic paradigm? I'm just thinking, we talked about wind and solar. Thinking about those systems, it's like solar panels need precious metals. It takes large amounts of fossil fuels to create them. Wind energy, disrupting migratory bird patterns, definitely placing a burden on rural communities over urban. I'm just wondering, it seems like a lot of the conversation is focused around replacing energy resources as opposed to reducing our consumption.
All right, thank you all very much for a very, very provocative discussion here at the end. And thanks to our three presenters for the wonderful presentation. We have a short break.
Yeah. Thanks, one and all. 10 minutes, 11 o'clock start. Please feed and quench your thirst on the various things we have. You're most welcome.